Welcome to Driving Forces, where we focus on the big issues in the city, state, and also national politics, areas that matter to you. I'm Jeff Simmons, and I'm alone today because my lovely co-host, Celeste Katz, is out of town visiting the parents. So as our listeners are aware of, Celeste and I love to talk about politics and policy. And last week, thanks to Celeste, we had on presidential candidate Eric Swalwell. And we're committed to inviting a number of the candidates on to talk about the issues that they care about and that we hope you care about, too. So today's big news here in New York City is that our very own mayor, Bill de Blasio, announced formally that he's going to be running for president, or he is running for president, becoming the 24th Democrat to enter the race. He released a 3-minute campaign video that trumpets the slogan, "Working People First," and it highlights his accomplishments and takes aim at the sitting president, branding Donald Trump a longtime bully. Mayor de Blasio is facing a number of challenges. For one, a later start than the other candidates that announced before him, a number of folks who'd worked with him before in other campaigns who are not at present working with him on this one, and if history is any guide, no sitting mayor has ever been elected to the presidency. So today, in the first half of our show, we're going to be talking, starting off shortly, with someone who knows the mayor extremely well, First Lady Chirlane McCray. The two celebrated their wedding anniversary earlier this week, and our listeners should know that when we first booked Chirlane McCray to be on today, several weeks ago, it was to talk about the Weekend of Faith that she's launching. So I'm going to spend a few minutes on that as well when she joins us. And afterwards, we're going to talk with Alyssa Katz. She is the deputy editor at the spanking new investigative journalism venture, The City, and a former member of the New York Daily News editorial board. And then we're going to bring you a conversation with the new City University Chancellor, Felix Matos Rodriguez. But first, we're trying to raise $500 today. If you can pledge, if you listeners like our show, please pledge $50 to support commercial-free WBAI, and we'll send you a special gift. It is I Think You're Wrong, But I'm Listening, a book by Beth Silvers and Sarah Stewart Holland. They're the hosts of the popular podcast Pantsuit Politics. Beth and Sarah joined us right here on WBAI a few weeks ago, and the book talks about how you can really communicate even when you disagree, particularly during this campaign climate. It's a great read. We'd like to send you a copy. We would really at BAI appreciate a gift of $50, and all you need to do is call 516-620-3602 right now and help us to keep bringing you real talk about real politics every day here on Driving Forces. Again, that number is 516-620-3602. So as I mentioned, my first guest today is the First Lady of New York City. She's recognized as a champion of mental health reform, and she was dubbed one of Time Magazine's 50 most influential people in healthcare for 2018. She is the driving force behind the city's Thrive NYC initiative, and she spearheads the city's Thrive Coalition with more than 200 mayors and other officials from across the country. And she chairs the Mayor's Fund to Advance New York City. It's a pleasure to have her join us today for her first interview since this morning's announcement. Welcome to Driving Forces.
Hello, Jeff. How are you?
It's wonderful to reconnect, and it was great to see you at the Inner Circle several weeks ago.
Yes. Up until then, it's been quite a while since I've seen you last.
So I must start with the question of the day. Anything new going on in your life today?
You're very funny. Yes, we have a Weekend of Faith that we are launching this evening, actually in just an hour or two, in the Bronx. We're going to be gathering to break fast before prayers on St. Raymond Avenue. The Weekend of Faith is this is our fourth one, and we expect a huge attendance because word spreads. And faith leaders have been some of our strongest allies in the Thrive effort.
And, so, and you mentioned this is the fourth annual. What are some of the events that take place?
Well, what happens is faith leaders all over the city and now all over the country gather together with their congregations and devote part of their services to talking about mental health. That is to raise awareness, to direct people to services within their communities, services and resources. But most importantly, to help get rid of the stigma And so many of our communities, the stigma is so great. You know, people are reluctant to even talk about mental illness or substance misuse. When the clergy leader, when the faith leader makes it a centerpiece of their service and says, you know, we're gonna talk about this, it goes a long way to dispel the myths and the misconceptions that people have, because our faith leaders are trusted leaders in their community. They're first responders. They often know the people in their congregations from birth, and they know their families. They see them every week, and so it goes a long way to help dispel the stigma that exists. We want people to talk about mental health. We want people to know that more about mental illnesses. This year we're focusing on stress and depression, because we want people to know that if they act early, they can actually feel a lot better faster.
And as I think about the iftar, I mean, New York City is home to thousands, tens of thousands of Muslims with diverse backgrounds, people of every faith. But in this country, we've been witnessing increased incidents of hate and negative rhetoric surrounding people of faith. What's the message you want to send by hosting this event?
Well, I want people to know that you know, we can't run away, but that we need each other, that these spaces, which are supposed to be safe spaces, it is just, it's so awful that we've had so many spaces be violated. But we can't run away, because that is what those who would persecute Muslims want to happen. As humans, we need connection. We need connection with each other. We need to be able to support one another. And so it is not a good idea for us to... Not a good time for us to for people to isolate themselves.
So I want to get to, obviously, the news of the day. Earlier this morning, it became formal that the mayor has announced that he is running for president. What are the factors that played into the decision to run?
Well, Jeff, you know, people all over this country are suffering. There's a lot of pain. There has been a misdirection of resources to the 1%. And Bill and I really want to put working families, working people first. And you probably heard him say, there's plenty of money in the world, in the country, is just in the wrong hands. And I certainly believe that. You know, we had an expression in my household growing up that there's more than enough for everyone. Some people just want more than their share. So we're going to be traveling around America, talking with people, listening to them, engaging in conversations to learn more about what it is they're looking for in a leader. Just as I did with Thrive, before Thrive launched. We took 11 months just to talk with people, listen to them, ask them what was missing, what their experiences were with mental health services. I'm really going to be continuing the work that I've been doing.
So to the naysayers, to those who've been focused on any issues or setbacks in the administration, what do you want to say about how the mayor's message, in your view, is going to resonate across the country?
Well, I can tell you that so far, the mayor's message resonates very well. It is not, will not be our first trip to Iowa or South Carolina. And people are, again, I tell you, people are in pain. We are very lucky in New York City in many ways. We have not had funding and services cut from healthcare the way other states and cities have. And so they're very impressed with what we are doing. And when we tell them that we have, 70,000 four-year-olds enrolled in pre-kindergarten, that's very impressive. That number, 70,000, is the size of the entire school district in Boston. people want these programs. People want this kind of support. It's very tough out there for even for working families, for two-income families, people working multiple jobs just to pay the rent and put food on the table and be able to care for their children. It's very rough. And so Bill's message is very welcome. And what we're saying about mental health is very welcome, too. Go ahead.
Oh, and so I noticed also in the commercial, so the mayor took immediate aim at the president, calling him a bully, a longtime bully. The president, responded in typical tweet fashion, calling the mayor a joke. What do you want to have to say about that? What's your response to the way the president responded?
I don't have a response. It's not where I like to put my time and energy. I'm very focused on the work and about putting forth a positive message. Maybe you can get Bill on the show. He might have something to say for you.
So another thing, as someone who is incredibly impressed with the campaign spot involving your son earlier, Dante, do you think we're going to be seeing Dante, who graduates this coming Monday from Yale? Congratulations. Will we see him? Will we see him? He will now have some time to be on the campaign or be in a campaign spot?
I just don't know. I no longer speak for our young people. They're young adults now, starting their lives, and of course they are supportive. But I really can't say.
So, in the campaign spot, you do talk about mental health. I'm expecting or assuming that this is going to be a key part of what you'll be talking about across the country. Can you just talk a little about that and about what you see as the major successes of Thrive NYC?
Well, Jeff, we have never had a behavioral health system in this country. And that is really appalling, given what we know about behavioral health. We have a rising suicide rate. We're in the middle of an opioid epidemic. We have a hospital emergency departments that are inundated with alcohol-related visits. I can tell you, 1 year in New York City alone, we had 116,000 alcohol-related visits, and no one is really talking about this. No one is connecting the dots between all the ways that mental illness and substance misuse affect our children, affect adults in the workplace, and in their relationship. This is really just, I'm aghast. And there is so much that we can do. With Thrive, we are reaching thousands and thousands of people with a central point of access. NYC Well has received roughly more than half a million calls, texts. We know that people are really hungry for support. And that is why we are putting such an emphasis also on place-based services. So we have been working with our community-based organizations and our senior centers to make sure that they are expanding the services that they already provide, making sure their staff gets trained in mental health first aid and other kinds of programs that will help them relate to people who are suffering. Also, making sure there are more counselors available in senior centers and in community-based organizations and neighborhoods that are underserved.
So we've got just about 2 minutes left, and I want to just come back to the campaign for a second, because mental health seems like it will be a key issue. And in the campaign spot, I noted that there were certain accomplishments that the mayor had focused on. What do you think is going to distinguish his campaign, your campaign, and set you apart from the other almost two dozen candidates in this race?
I think the focus, working families, working people, is is an important focus and something that I really haven't heard the same way from other candidates. I also believe that Bill has executive experience, certainly as a leader of one of the largest cities in the country, and with so many accomplishments under his belt. He is very well qualified, not only to talk about what we can do for the rest of the country, but actually implement. So you take a program like Prepay for All. This is something that can happen everywhere. Guaranteed health care for all. That can also happen everywhere. And it is, New York City is now the safest big city in the country. We know a thing or two about how to do this work. We know about neighborhood policing. This is not something that is theoretical for us. So I think that you can look to hear much more of that in the coming months, because we do have a message to share with other people. And let me tell you, Jeff, people are listening.
So this is a big undertaking. If you think about the next year, year and a half, as we wrap up, what are the emotions you're going through on a day like today when you start to look at the next, you know, the next year?
Well, you know, I think that's not the right approach to look at the next year. I think, you know, what do they say? That the I can't remember the expression, but you can only take one step at a time.
Mm-hmm.
I take one day at a time. Otherwise, it does become very overwhelming. that's how you do a journey. You know, you take one step at a time.
So as we wrap up, how can people learn more about your work and follow you and you know, I'll say the campaign, but also the work that you're doing in the city?
Well, I hope people will participate in the Weekend of Faith. It runs from today, May 16th through 19th, and anyone can participate. It doesn't matter what their faith is, and if they belong to a community center, they can participate that way. There's a phone number they can call to get a toolkit. We want to make sure that people have guidance with these conversations. The phone number is 212-748-0336. Again, the number is 212-748-0336. You call that number, you can get a toolkit and participate with your house of worship or with your community center in our Weekend of Faith on Mental Health. I also have a Twitter handle, at NYC First Lady. That's at NYC First Lady. Please follow me.
Madam First Lady. Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry.
And if people want to learn more about Thrive, they can go to thrivenyc.cityofnewyork.
Madam First Lady Chirlane McCray, thank you for joining me, Jeff Simmons, here on WBAI.
Thank you, Jeff. It's been nice talking with you.
Same here. So for our listeners, in a few moments, we're going to bring on a guest to talk about the mayor's campaign. But I do want to remind you that it is the season for fundraising, because as my predecessor in the show that preceded me today, John Cain, talked about, we also have the More Than Mics campaign. I hope you're listening to John Cain as well, by the way, because his show is fantastic. But we have the More Than Mics campaign so we could build out our studio right down the hall. And I knew we were getting close to that $10,000 goal, and it would be wonderful if you're able to just even call 516-620-3602 to contribute, or you can go online to give to wbai.org. Again, that's give to wbai.org. And if you're walking around and you're listening to us, because we do stream at wbai.org, you can then just punch it on your smartphone, text WBAI to 41444 and make a contribution. And as I mentioned at the outset of the show, If you want to receive a gift, such as the book, I Think You're Wrong, But I'm Listening, you can pledge $50 to support our commercial-free operation, and you could get this book written by Beth Silvers and Sarah Stewart Holland. They're the hosts of the popular podcast, Pantsuit Politics. So we just wrapped up a few minutes ago talking with First Lady Chirlane McCray, and I thought it would be good to then bring on another guest who can who has followed the mayor's campaign, followed this, or rather the administration, soon the campaign, Alyssa Katz. She's the deputy editor at The City, which is a new journalism platform that recently launched just a month ago. She's a former member of the New York Daily News editorial board. Alyssa, welcome to Driving Forces.
Thank you so much.
So looking back at the last, I'll say 24 hours, because it started to leak out late afternoon yesterday, what do you think about the rollout and how this took place?
Well, I mean, in many ways, Mayor de Blasio followed the usual playbook, right? He started with a video posted to YouTube early in the morning describing who he is, what he's all about, and what his message is. Then went on a national TV show, went on Good Morning America with First Lady Chirlane McCray, who you just had on. The message was a little incongruous with the general tone of GMA, but they did the interview and really laid out a signature message of that there's plenty of money in the world, there's plenty of money in this country, it's just in the wrong hands.
What would you say are some of the challenges ahead for the mayor?
Wow. Well, there are many, right? I mean, he's, of course, entering a field now that already has 22 other candidates for the Democratic nomination for president. And he's starting, late in the game with little fundraising and also very low poll numbers, which matters because in order to get on the stage for the Democratic Party primary debates, you need to have some reasonably high standing on both those fronts. So not that he can't do it. He's a very experienced political hand and has networks, but still it's a crowded field, and he's going to have to get through that. The other obstacle is just that his, and talking about polling, it's not just the number, but the overall preference of voters for him ranks very low in such a crowded field, but also that his favorability ratings are quite negative compared to other candidates, that well, some people like him okay, a lot of people don't, and the number of people who don't really is really higher for him compared to the number of people who do support him than any other candidate in that field. So he's going to have to move the needle on both of those numbers.
Do you consider him an underdog at this point?
Well, it's an interesting question. I mean, of course, given everything I just said, he's certainly an underdog on any of those counts, and he kind of relishes talking about how he has been viewed as an underdog before. I think most notably in the 2013 mayoral contest that he ultimately won. And I think that some of the ways in which he won in 2013 are kind of instructive to how he might advance himself in the Democratic field, even if he doesn't win. I think there's a narrative out there, and I heard some of it on social media in the past 24 hours, of just, that, well, of course he won in 2013 because everyone around him collapsed, that Anthony Weiner imploded and this, and you go through each of the candidates. And that is true, but we forget for one thing that the one reason that Christine Quinn plummeted in the polls after being the presumptive favorite at that point was that she started being the subject of attack ads that were funded in part by anti-horse carriage advocates, right, who had some money. But then we forget, I think, it's easy to forget, that the other big source of funding for those attack ads was actually the union run by Mayor de Blasio's cousin, and that was the source of the funding. It was under the radar because the money came in late and kind of evaded the campaign finance radar, but there it was. And I think that speaks to the kind of very shrewd political strategist that Bill de Blasio is, and that was his career before he was mayor and public advocate and city council member. It's easy to forget that and a mistake to forget that, too.
So one of your colleagues, Yoav Gonen, had posted a piece earlier this week. I think it might have been yesterday or the day before, about Bill de Blasio's New York City record. And it kind of assesses a number of his signature issues and where he is very strong at. Can you talk a little about some of the successes that you think he's going to continue to focus on that will resonate across the country?
Sure, and just to give credit where it's due, is actually our senior, most of our senior reporting staff. So it was at, this is at thecity.nyc. So it was Yoav Gonen, Rosa Goldenson, Ruvane Blau, Greg B. Smith, and Jose Martinez. and so we have, you know, basically how almost half our reporting staff really go over de Blasio's record. And I want to be clear, what we went over was really the goals that he had set for himself, right? So he went out there and said, okay, I'm going to get universal pre-K and I'm going to get health care for all, make this the safest big city in America, and so forth. And so he had kind of set up slogans and goals on affordable housing, improving police community relations, and so on. And measured on his own yardstick, you know, we found that on the whole, you know, in a lot of ways he did very well. In other ways, especially on police community relations, clearly has enormous challenges, right, and big problems, in part because he refuses to stand up to the NYPD because of just the consequences that he saw when he attempted to, you know, really get more demanding on how they run things following the Eric Garner killing. So, you know, we could go through each issue, better just to go to thecity.nyc and read through the very detailed run-through. But I think I want to add an important footnote to what I, you know, am just reviewing, which is that while he, on his own programs that are kind of the signature accomplishments that he's looking to run on now, I think the mayor's done well enough in delivering on them because these were his programs, his initiatives, sort of what his mayoralty would live or die by. I think part of the paradox that is Bill de Blasio is that he, and meanwhile, kind of tragically neglected these legacy institutions from the New Deal and Great Society that he said were his inspiration for all his new initiatives, but kind of took for granted that, for instance, the New York City Housing Authority, the subways, the libraries, that, you know, in public hospitals, like all these institutions have really wanted for investments of resources and political attention that he's now belatedly giving because he's been forced to by legal authorities in the case of NYCHA, by the subway breakdowns in the case of the MTA, and so on, and the public hospitals because he can't keep shoveling money into them. But really, so he's turning them around now. In fact, his health care for all program is in fact basically a marketing program to get New Yorkers to use the public hospitals, which is great. But he spent 5 years initially really figuring the public hospitals would take care of themselves when people at the system who paid attention to its budget problems recognized that it was in desperate shape, and he didn't do anything about it or anything much about it. So it's a mixed record in that sense. His own attention to his own shiny objects, right, the new programs that he wanted to tout, kind of starved attention and resources from the existing programs, and that's a problem the city is still very much dealing with.
So I gather, I mean, everyone's focused on the one of the most recent Quinnipiac polls that had indicated that 76% of registered voters thought he should not run for president. You know, what are your expectations as he starts to crisscross across the country? Are you thinking that at home we're going to be seeing more people grumbling and his rating, you know, poll numbers are going to go down here? Or do you think that when they see how he's performing across the country with more attention, that might sway more people to be supportive?
Yeah, I've been wondering about that. And just to make clear, as you've implied, the 76% of voters who didn't want him to run are New York City voters. And
yes,
we are unusually cantankerous and obviously know Bill de Blasio very well. No, I do think that if his message and campaigning do get traction across the country, that New Yorkers might be a little bit more reflective. Although I think, you know, just as a basic matter of principle, that, you know, we as a city are entitled to the full services and attention of the mayor that we elected and paid. So no matter how well he does, and even if he wins, you know, I still feel like the deprivation of a public official services, right? Like he doesn't get to move to a part-time salary. We don't get to elect another mayor. You know, I think that is going to sting regardless. But yeah, I mean, it'll be interesting to see if America gives us a different perspective at home. It could certainly happen.
So, Alyssa, as I wrap up, the toughest question you're going to get, how can people follow you and learn more about the city?
Well, great. And the city is, to be clear, the nonprofit news site where I'm the deputy editor, not the city of New York. And you can find us at thecity.nyc. It is all free, although, of course, like WBAI, we appreciate donations from our audience. Thank you so much.
And the article I was referring to, when you go on to thecity.nyc, it is called Progressive Promises Bill de Blasio's New York City Record. I just want to point that out. I'll post the link on our Driving Forces Facebook page. Alyssa Katz, thank you so much for joining me here on WBAI.
You're very welcome. It's been a pleasure.
So you are listening to Driving Forces here on WBAI New York 99.5 FM, also streaming live at WBAI.org. I'm Jeff Simmons. My amazing co-host Celeste Katz is off today. We'll be back definitely next week. Anxious to have her back here in the studio. We are also, as I pointed out at the beginning of the show, we are in fundraising drive. If you enjoy our show, whether you're commuting and you're listening to us in the car, or you're at home, or you're even in the office and have WBA on, we'd love for you to show your support, because if you want to us to continue to have the guests that everyone's talking about on our show, well, we're going to keep pursuing them. As I mentioned, we had Eric Swalwell, presidential candidate, last week. We are pursuing other presidential candidates as well, including Bernie Sanders, to see if we can get him on the show, because we know you would like to hear that. But we're just trying to raise $500 today. And if you're able during this show, and if you're able to pledge $50 by calling 516-620-3602, or if you can't do $50, that's fine. Any amount except for zero counts. Any amount really would count. You can pledge at 516-620-3602 or go online to give to WBAI.org. That's give the number to WBAI.org, or go in your smartphone and text WBAI to 41444. And also, if you're looking to get a gift when you donate, we also have this book that we called I Think You're Wrong, But I'm Listening, by Beth Silvers and Sarah Stewart Holland. They are the hosts of the popular podcast Pantsuit Politics. And we had them on, Celeste and I had them on a few weeks ago. And basically, during this polarizing political climate, when often people who disagree can't do it in a very calm way, they kind of help you navigate, the reader navigate, how to get through these difficult conversations. It is a great read, and we'd love to send you a copy to thank you for your gift of $50. So you just have to call 516-620-3602. Say you're making the gift in recognition of Driving Forces. If you want to be acknowledged on the air, definitely say that too, because if James gets words, right, James, he'll say something?
Absolutely. I'd be more than happy to do that.
Thank you so much. So just call 516-620-3602. So as I mentioned at the outset of the show, another guest that I have wanted to talk with is the new City University of New York Chancellor, Felix Matos Rodriguez. He earlier this month took the reins of the CUNY system. And CUNY, as many of you probably know, is the nation's largest urban public university. It was founded in 1847 and serves more than 275,000 degree-seeking students, and it's comprised of 25 different institutions. We are honored to have him on the show with only a few weeks after he began. Chancellor, welcome to Driving Forces.
Thank you, Jeff. Thank you for having me in the program. It's an honor to be with you, and this is my second week in the job.
Oh, it's your second week. And, you know, I should clarify, because from something I read, as much as you are wearing this hat, you were also just staying on a little bit longer as the president of Queens College for a specific reason. And can you tell our listeners why?
Oh, thank you so much. Yes, I was so happy that our board chair, Bill Thompson, allowed me to. When they offered the job, I said the one thing that I want to do is I want to be there at my commencement for my students at Queens of the class of 2019, and the chair was very gracious and then allowed me to do this. So I'm actually, the students call me the Chancident, because I'm chancellor and president for a month, and those students will have a historic diploma, the first time that someone gets the same signature twice in the same city university diploma. So it'd be a collector's item.
So I'm familiar with your background. I live in Queens. I believe I interviewed you also years ago for the Hispanic Outlook in Higher Education. So I'm familiar with your background. Can you give our listeners first some insight into your background and your career?
Well, thank you. I am born and raised in Puerto Rico. I came to the U.S. to pursue my educational dreams. I'm a historian, so I taught history of Latin America and the Caribbean and Latinos in the U.S. Came to Hunter College about 20 years ago, really inspired by the mission of the City University of New York. So I came as a faculty member, directed the Center for Puerto Rican Studies back then, served 4 years as advisor and commissioner in the government of Puerto Rico, social services, and then came back to be the president for 5 years at Hostos Community College in the South Bronx, and then the last 5 years at Queens. So a career combining academia and higher education, public service, and a very blessed man.
And you're not the first in your family to pursue education, correct?
My grandmother was she taught English in the public schools in Puerto Rico, so she was a school teacher for many years. My dad was an engineer, and my mother was studying to be a teacher. Then I was born, and plans were changed.
So you're the first person of color to lead CUNY in its 172 years, and I had read that the head of the Hispanic Association of Colleges and Universities, HACU, had said your naming had national implications. How so?
I think that public institutions need to be responding to the communities that they serve. And one of the ways in which you do that is really trying to mirror somewhat the communities that you serve. And in a city of New York, that speaks to our great diversity. So I think that this is a story that celebrates the investments that CUNY has made over the years in having larger numbers of faculty of color. I mean, I came to the system as a faculty member, as I mentioned before. And again, the important thing about being a historic first is making sure that you open the doors for others that will come after you. So that's how I envision this this great honor that has been bestowed upon me.
What impact do you personally hope that your presence as chancellor has on the composition of faculty and the student body?
I mean, in all places, right, we like to see people like us, and that allows us to think that we can be in that position, that we can achieve that. So that is something that I have experienced even as a faculty member, that the students will tell you. It's good to see somebody that looks like us, that has our story, that shares our background, so that's very important in higher education in the universities, and it speaks to access and inclusion, which is something which is tied to the DNA of the City University since its origins as the Free Academy. So I am very honored, and probably took a little longer than it should have. But I think it marks a point of moving forward, and again, it's entirely consistent with the history of our great university.
So recently here on the show, we had on a number of the candidates for district attorney in Queens. And one of the questions that I really wanted to ask each one that I found insightful was about the culture that they would want their administration to be known for. So as you in this new role, what do you want the culture to be like CUNY administration?
Well, thank you for that. That's a great question. And I think that you want to send a message that we care, right? And that might sound simple, but when you care, you're efficient with the resources that you have, and you make sure that you deliver the services and the education in this case that we promise our students. You know, when you care, you think about individuals as a whole, and that we need to think about our students. As students, as family members, as parents in the case that they might be. And so for me, that would be a really, really important sense, that we really care about our students, we care about our faculty and our staff, we care about the communities where we are anchor institutions and depend on us for so many things, workforce development, cultural life. And I think that if we do that, we'll be very successful in being excellent and efficient.
So one thing I always find amusing is I used to be an education reporter at a number of different publications, and people would assume that, oh, it's you're nearing the end of the academic year. Wow, you're going to have it easy. Schools are shut down. So, but what I learned as an education reporter is so much happens preparing for that next academic year. So we're getting to the point where, like, you've probably already been planning a lot for this next academic year and even the summer session. What are some of your top priorities?
Well, I think one of the key things, even for someone like me who's been part of the system and has been in three other campuses, is not to assume that because I've been here, I'm familiar with all the complexity. You mentioned the vastness of our system when, you know, in your opening piece. So I'm going to spend some time listening to the colleges, you know, in the campuses and our stakeholders. There are a couple of I think, you know, important things that we're going to be able to advance. And you know, I think one area, for example, where we have been making some progress, but we have a lot of additional work to do is career engagement in terms of making sure that our students, from the moment that they come to our campus, begin to think about what happens next, and we start creating internships opportunities and service learning. We know that when students have paid internships, they get a job faster when they graduate, and they have higher incomes, you know, in that first job, which is important for your salary afterwards. So that's something that I already been out in my 2 weeks talking to the Partnership for New York City, with some other funders about this. So this is, I think, something where we have done some good things, but we can do a lot more on behalf of our students.
What are some of the, I mean, it's been reported in a number of periodicals about some of the challenges. What would you say are some of the key challenges that CUNY faces that you want to tackle head on? Or, you know, if some, I'm sure some are going to take, you know, a while, but what are some of the challenges that you'd like to first start to address?
Well, I mean, as I mentioned to you, I think that if you care about student success, that whole area of career engagement is something that we need to do a little bit better as a university. We are a vast system, and I think another challenge that we have is really finding ways to be less bureaucratic in the way that we approach our work, let it be admitting students, doing our day-to-day business, the way that we also work with each other as colleagues. I think there's a lot of work that we need to be, that we can do in that area, which would, A, create more efficient services to our students and stakeholders, but also would save some dollars that we could reinvest in our students. There's, I mean, we are a vast system, and we're unique in that you can go from getting, you know, your GED all the way to a professional program in our system. We could probably do a lot better also in some of the articulation, making sure that it was easier to move from one place to the next. So I think those are areas that if we make some headway, we'll be really having a significant impact on people's lives and achieve higher student success, and then also maybe even save some dollars that we can reinvest back in our campuses.
So you've been given credit for addressing, for making strides in combating dropout rates at Ostos and Queens College. What would you say is key, you know, key to success, to improving the dropout rates, to keeping students in school?
Well, one thing is that was a team effort, right? It happens to be my bio, but it's a team effort. I want to accentuate this. You don't have any large effective change if you don't work as a team. But, you know, some of those things, for example, we learned from our great accelerated program in ASAP, that one of the key things, and that was a program that has doubled the graduation rates for community college students, that one key element in that program was intrusive advisement. So at Ostos, for example, We got additional dollars, and we used them to hire a lot more advisors. So there was somebody there that from the moment that Jeff came to the campus, he had one person that, you know, took care of you. And those are sometimes small things that make the difference in making sure that the students, you know, to graduate the student, they need to be retained. So we need people that understand what our students are going through and can provide professional, academic, personal advice to get them to succeed. So advising is a key part of any student success agenda.
And I would imagine that one of your goals is also to ensure that the CUNY credential connects with a successful career. How do you make that happen?
Well, I mean, first is you need to have the different stakeholders, and in this I mean, for example, sectors of industry when you're talking about programs that might be of a more professional nature, if you wish, right? That they need to be at the table giving us feedback on how the field is changing and what do they need when they enter. We also know that employers tell us that they want them with practical skills, but they want people who are good critical thinkers, right? So we also need to continue to do well on things that are basics like writing and public speaking and working in teams, right? Things that don't belong to any major, but you're gonna need in any job that you go to. And I think moving forward, we know that the economy of the future is gonna be one in which we're gonna have to reinvent ourselves periodically. So I think that we need to instill in our students the DNA of that desire of, continuous learning, that whatever field you take, journalism, health, law, social work, teaching, that the future is going to demand that you at some point go back for additional schooling, credentials, certificates, because if not, you're not going to be able to be effective and keep your job. And we need to make sure our students leave our programs with that DNA of knowing that we've done well for what they came for, but that they can come back for more, hopefully to our campuses, for that next level of training that they might need.
So as we wrap up, how can people learn more about you? And if they're a student interested in enrolling in CUNY, you know, sell them on a CUNY education right now. Tell them why it's valuable to them.
Easy to go through our main website, www.cuny.edu, and you can access all our 25 campuses. So if you're interested in professional programs, you know, you want to get a degree in public health, journalism, medical school, law school, labor studies, the graduate center, we have that. Two-year colleges for the students, you know, coming maybe out of high school. For adults who might have some credentials and want to come back, our School of Professional Studies is very flexible. So we have excellent programs for students of all ages in all the five boroughs and beyond. So we are a really excellent university at a really, really fair price. We're the American Dream Machine, and we're proud of it.
And one thing as I close, because you mentioned Bill Thompson at the start, I used to work for Bill Thompson. So I'm just warning you that one of the things he had me work on was the 100-day report, to have that ready like 100 days after he took office. So I'm just giving you that heads up. He might put that on you too.
So I have then about, 86 days? So thank you so much, and I'm on it. But it's a delight to have Bill as at the chair. We have a great board, and I look forward to working with him and the rest of the board moving forward. But thank you for your time, and thank you for being so supportive of our work at CUNY.
Chancellor, thank you so much for joining me here on Driving Forces.
Take care, Jeff.
So we've got, James, we've got under 10 minutes left. Should we just open it up to see if there are some calls?
Why not?
Okay.
You only live once.
The number two call to weigh in about the mayor, about the chancellor, about anything you've heard on the show or whatever else is on your mind, under 10 minutes, 212-209-2877. That's 212-209-2877. And as we wait for anyone to give us a call, I just want to remind you that if you do wish to contribute today, if you enjoy WBAI, any of the wonderful programs, including James's program that I love listening to, please donate to 516-620-3602. I believe we even have someone who's calling in already, but again, that number is 516-620-3602, or go online to give to WBAI.org. We have a caller on the line. What's your name and where are you from? Hi, welcome to WBAI.
Yes, hi. I'm just curious. I know WBAI is very progressive and very inquisitive. How come you ask such softball questions to your interviews? People will come on. Why is it like there's no challenge? Is this like mainstream radio? I mean, this you have people, you know.
I don't consider it softball. I think it is in my nature not to be combative.
I didn't say combative. But you don't even challenge him on the current community college graduation rate after 6 years. I mean, the community college is the key factor here. I mean, there's no follow up. I mean, this is WBAI. Come on, this is a joke. You're a joke.
Well, no. It's okay, James. That's okay. You know what?
No, you're going to cut me off.
I'm ready. No, I'm not going to argue with the sir. I'm not going to cut you off. I'm just going to say we have a difference of opinion on that. I really am interested, and I hope a number of our listeners are too, in what our guests have to say. Everything that they say you're going to agree with.
So let's take an example of the internship that you brought up. Nonsense. There are no internships anymore, paid internships. It's very difficult to get.
So let me flip it on one thing. What do you think? Let me take it away from the interview itself. What do you think?
No,
what
I want to talk about the interview because I called about the interview. He's talking about hiring guidance counselors.
No. I'm asking you for your answer. What do you think the system needs to do then?
Well, the system needs to really provide a foundation for entry students in the community college that are coming into college without the basic skills. And that's, it's not that they are capable as anyone else, but they just lack the foundation because of the high school, the neighborhood, the stresses, the economic stresses. I mean, that's the problem. It's about the community college. You know, when you have a tree and you have to have a foundation, you have to have the appropriate amount of soil and water, you know, that the 20% graduation rate after 6 years for this CUNY community college. That's horrible. That's terrible. What is he talking about career-oriented? People don't know what they want to do when they go for the first or second year, what job they want. He's talking about hiring guidance counselors. Who's going to pay these guidance counselors? It's ridiculous. You don't follow up with anything. You don't follow up with any critical... I don't understand this. This is WBAI. You should be ashamed of yourself.
Well, that's where I disagree with you. And, you know,
you had nothing. Either you don't need
I'm gonna have to close the show anyway in a few minutes. I honestly gave you a good amount of time to be able to voice your opinion. I thank you for that. You said a 20%, it's not much different. 22% of students who enter the system graduate in only 3 years. It's been a lingering problem. I know it's been a problem that this system has faced, and also the public school system as well. Has focused on this since I came to New York more than 2 decades ago. It has been a lingering problem. And you know what? That is also something I do expect and I do accept, which is if listeners do disagree with anything that we talk about on this show, I don't want to just take phone calls when people are calling to say, oh, you did a great job. That was wonderful. If you disagree with me, I want to hear those voices as well. That is what WBAI is about. That is why I just let that call stay on a little longer so that this gentleman could also be able to voice his opinion that he did feel strongly about. So as we are getting near to closing the show, I don't see any other calls now. So I just do want to remind our listeners, if you are at home and enjoying or in the car, or in your office and you're listening to BAI and you do want to support us, please give a call to 516-620-3602.
Actually, I can't think of many other stations that would allow a call like that to continue just because of the mood of the caller. I think people would be very quick to bail out.
I know, but truthfully, he felt...
He had good points, though.
He felt... Yeah, that's what I was going to say. He had... he brought up the rate, the 20%, 22% graduation rate within 3 years. That has been a lingering problem. Mm-hmm. And yeah, sometimes I don't get to ask the follow-up questions because I know our time is limited and I really want to hit on other things before we go. I also want it to be a little lighter interviews. I'm not doing any gotcha, but yeah, if I do hear something that seems a little off or that I have the time to be able to ask a follow-up, I will.
Absolutely. I've heard you do so.
So, but no, I do. That is why I also let that call stay on longer, because when we have that chance, we do. So again, as we're getting ready to wrap up, I want to remind our listeners we're on every Thursday. Driving Forces on every Thursday at 5 o'clock. My lovely colleague Celeste Katz will be back in studio next week. She's off just this week. I want to thank our guests, the First Lady Chirlane McCray, the CUNY Chancellor Felix Matos Rodriguez, also James for always being dazzling on the board, and of course you, our listeners, for supporting non-commercial, non-corporate radio. You can go on to WBAI.org right now, and you, if you'd like to donate, it is at give2wbai.org. But if you missed any part of this show and you want to upload, you know, we do upload every episode on SoundCloud and iTunes, but you could also go to the WBAI website and you'll be able to download the show as well. I'd like to thank you all for listening today. Have a great day.